Car's gas tank can hold 16 gallons of gas. It gets 24 miles per gallon when driving on the highway. Write an expression for the amount of gas left in the tank after X miles on the highway. Alright. You guys gotta start, us off somewhere. You gotta start with something. 16. Something about 16 is the beginning. Why are we gonna start with 16?
Because the tank has 16 gallons.
Okay, so we fill up the tank, we have 16 gallons. To start with, that's pretty important because what do we want to know?
How many gallons
left? They could ask questions like how far can you drive and how long and all that kind of stuff. But they want to know how many gallons are left.
You can get 24 miles per gallon.
That's important information, 24 miles per gallon. This is 16 gallons, right? How do we use that information?
X stands for miles, so 24X.
X miles. So something about 24X? What would 24X represent? No, if you look at it just from a unit standpoint, say X is 5, so 24 miles per gallon times. It's in miles, so say 4 miles over the 1. That's fine. But what do we get here? We get 96 miles times miles, miles squared. And that's giving like an area of a square mile. That doesn't seem like that's what we're supposed to wind up with, right? Okay. Somehow with X miles and 24 miles per gallon, we're supposed to be able to figure out what?
How many gallons?
We're supposed to try and take X miles and 24 miles per gallon and somehow translate that into gallons? Does that sound possible? Sounds like something we could do. It does sound like something. Right? There's gallons and there's miles per gallon. It seems like we should be able to go from gallons through miles per gallon to gallons. From miles through miles per gallon to gallons. But we should be able to translate that from one unit to another. How can I take X miles and use the 24 miles per gallon?
Over 24.
Let me just show you how that works from just converting units, right? Have you converted units before? Yes, you have. If you haven't, then you work really hard to avoid it because it gets taught a lot. Like trends going from meters to centimeters, or from yards to feet, or feet to miles, or anything like that. Or, you know, we call it dimensional analysis. And we're just exchanging from one unit to another unit. Okay? So, hey, multiply this by a fraction that's equal to 1. That's important. That means that whatever's here and whatever's here is equal to each other. So then you divide and you just get 1. And I do it in such a way that I can cancel out miles and leave myself with gallons, and we'll be in good shape. Do we have such a comparison between miles and gallons? That a certain number of miles is equal to a certain number of gallons? What is that? 24 miles for 1 gallon. These two things are exactly equivalent to each other in this case for this car. So I can trade out so many miles for so many gallons. Now if I just say, okay, for sure that the miles cancel out, I will be left with gallons. If I take the number given for X and divide it by the number 24, then I know all the units should work out because I did it over here. So X divided by 24 gives me a number of gallons, right? And so how is that going to interact with 16? You're going to minus. Here's another way to think about it. Here is X miles. Okay? Every 24 miles you drive, you've used a gallon, right? And that's useful information if we want to know how many gallons are left. So every 24 miles of that X miles, whatever X is, will well, this 24 miles is a gallon, this 24 miles is a gallon, this 24 miles is a gallon. And if I could count all of the groups of 24, then I would know how many gallons I've used. Right? And when I do this, when I draw this big number and I cut it into smaller numbers, it's division. And I'm taking x and I'm dividing it into groups of 24. That's x divided by 24. So it's another way to look at it. There we go. 16 minus x over 24. How about if we, we'll just do 4, and then I'll kind of comment on how 5 is really similar to 4. We'll only do 14, but then we'll see how similar 15 is to that. Or only do 4 and see how similar 5 is. All right. Here's the first thing that you may get confused about. And this happens for students all the way through every math, it seems like. You see a parenthesis there, and you see a parenthesis there. You have it in your head. The parentheses next to parentheses means multiply the parentheses together. That's not what's happening. Right? We got this parenthesis here. This parenthesis is over here. How are the parentheses being combined? This is being subtracted from that, right? All this stuff is getting subtracted from this stuff. So it's addition, subtraction, level stuff, not multiplication. They're not multiplying the parentheses together. So I need to figure out, what's this parentheses worth? What can this be simplified to, if it's possible to simplify it? And then, what will this group be worth once I've, what will I do with this negative?
Distribute.
Yes, distribute the negative throughout the entire parentheses. If I'm supposed to subtract everything in here, well, that's what distribution is, right? It's making sure that I subtract this, and I also subtract this, and I also subtract this. If I only put the negative on this guy here, I'm only subtracting the first thing, and then why did the person use parentheses in the first place? We're not going to respect that, right? So let's look inside the parentheses. Anything we can combine inside the parentheses? Can we simplify the parentheses? No. Is there anything happening to the parentheses? Right? Like, just, should I distribute something? Is it raised to a power? No, there's nothing happening to the parentheses. Why are there parentheses? Separate them? Are they, I mean, are they really serving any purpose? Is there some reason to separate? No, there's not really a reason. So we can just kind of drop them. Because again, there's no way to simplify, there's no like terms. There's also nothing happening to the parentheses. There's no negative to distribute, there's no number to distribute, there's no power that's being raised to, it's not being divided by anything. It's just, it's a group of stuff. It's grouped together, who knows why. Okay? Probably because it was a function and whatever. It doesn't really matter. If you want to feel like you've done some kind of math, there's a 1 in front there. You could distribute a positive 1 into there, but then you just get what I wrote. Here we're going to, right, we're going to add. We're going to add level here. If we add a negative, then that will be subtraction, right? We'll take care of that. We're going to add whatever comes out of this set of parentheses after we distribute that negative. So we get a positive x squared. We get a positive 5x. We get a positive 2. We're adding all those things. And now we look for like terms and combine like terms. So these are like terms. We got negative 4x squared. Let's see, 2x and 5x, that's 7x. 2 minus 1 is 1. Negative 4x squared is 7x plus 1. Now this one's like 4, but it's just like even more simple, right? There's nothing to distribute. There's no even really reason why these two things have parentheses around them, right? We're not multiplying, we're adding. If this plus was gone, that would be implied multiplication, but it's not gone. It's there. It's plus. Okay. All these parentheses are doing here is just kind of saying, like, do these things first, then do these things inside the parentheses. Once you have those two numbers that result from the parentheses, then add it together. But if I had a bunch of numbers here, it wouldn't matter even what order I did those things in. Right? Because it's all addition, including addition of negative numbers. And I can rearrange addition in any order I want. So parentheses don't matter. I'm just really collecting my terms right there. So if I go on to 12 and 13. Okay. talk about this kind of at length. I really want you to understand something important, but very simple, very not intimidating about graphs. So before we get into that too much again, let's just find the y for this x, and likewise for this one and this one. So for -3, you're gonna plug -3 in there, and if you've ever made a mistake plugging x into an expression, then I recommend that you always replace every x with an empty parentheses, then go back and fill those parentheses in. That way you can make sure, especially with negatives, that the negatives are exactly where they should be, right? Inside the parentheses, not outside. -3, -3, -3. 3 to the third power means I'm going to multiply something by itself 3 times. What is the number I'm multiplying by itself 3 times? -3 is the number I'm multiplying. So -3 times -3 times -3, what's that going to be? -27. All right. Plus, we're going to square -3. What's that? Well, after we multiply by itself. So we're going to square it. We're going to get times 9. We get -5 times -3 is +15. -6, -27. We got 18 there. +15 minus 6. What do we wind up? 33. 0?
Mm-hmm.
0. Do the same with -2. -2 cubed plus -2 times -2 squared minus 5 times -2 minus 6. I made sure that in every parentheses goes the -2. -2 cubed, that's going to be -8. +2 times, that's going to be +4. It's going to be +10 minus 6. -8 plus 8, we're going to cancel. +10 minus 6, that's 4. 0, that's easy. -6. And then what do we get for 2 and 3? 2 zeros as well. 4. That's quite a jump from 0 to 24. Okay. So now we come to what a graph is. And to your question, let's put our first point down, -3, 0. So I put that point down. Now if we can answer the question about what I'm about to ask, then we'll pretty much answer our question of where do I begin, how do I connect the dots, okay? So what does that point in that place represent? What does it tell us about the function we're dealing with? No. The starting, there's no starting point, right? Because it goes on forever in either direction. So we don't exactly start anywhere. Is this particular point, where is this point? Where is it? Okay, you're right, it's on the x-axis. That is significant. I was looking for something else, but you're right. If you were to tell me where to put it, if it weren't there yet, how would you tell me where to put it? -2, 0, we just got it kind of mixed up. -3, 0, right? And what does a point at -3, 0 tell me about this function? A specific point with those specific values. It's this point. The fact that it's at -3, 0, that it's x is -3, that's y is 0, what does it tell you about this function? When you put -3 in for x, you get out 0. Right? Remember how we talked about what a function is? Very basic. You put something in, you get something out. If you let that sink into your head, you start thinking about it that way, that that's what a function is, it will help you out a lot. Okay? This is something that you don't want to just gloss over. Say like, yeah, that's probably not very important what he's saying right now. I'm saying, a function is something you put something into and get something out of, and if we can think of it that way, it answers a lot of questions now and for a very, very long time in the future. Okay? So this point represents that if you put in negative 3, you get out 0. If I put in negative 2, I get 4, and that's what this point represents. If I put in 0, I'll get out negative 6. If I put in 2, I'll get out 0. If I put in 3, I'll get out 24, and that's really too big to put on the graph. That is off the graph. So now we ask ourselves, how do we connect these points? Let's look from... Keep in mind, we start with x, right? X goes into the function. It's kind of a horizontal, kind of on the graph, you can think kind of left to right orientation. If we look in between this point and this point on the x-axis, this input and this input, if I put in this input of negative 3, I get an output of 0, right? If I put in this input of negative 2, I get the output 4. What if I put in the input negative 2.5? What kind of output do you think I will get? And it is just a guess. You're just guessing. Negative 2.5, what kind of output do you think I'll get? 2. Do you think that's a fair guess that we'll get 2? Sure. Could it be more than 2? Maybe less than 2? Yeah. Who really knows until we put it in there? But why does everybody feel like, yeah, that's... I can agree to that. It kind of feels like it would be at 2. It looks like there's some kind of a pattern forming here, right? The shape that we draw isn't really a shape at all, as strange as that might seem. We're not really drawing a shape. We're giving up on points. We are tired of plotting points. You see what I'm saying? We plotted 5 points, and what I'm saying to you is I want to know where all of these points will
be. By connecting the dots, you're showing where the output will be.
Yes. Where your educated guess is, right? It would make a lot of sense if we got an output of around 2 when we put in negative 2.5. Because when we put in negative 3, we get 0. When we put in negative 2, we get 4. So somewhere between there is what I should get when I put something that's in between those two x values. And again, this output might be a little bigger, might be a little smaller, but somewhere in that range. If it was up here, would you believe it? I would be hesitant to believe it, right? Now, could it be? Could you get that as an output? I guess, but it would be pretty hard to believe. If I got that as my output and I put a point right there and all the other points were in here, I would check my work again. I could check my work and say, I don't think that's right. And then if I do it again and it comes out the same, and I do it a third time and it comes out the same, now I'm pretty sure that's the output, but it sure is surprising. Right? But that's what we're talking about when we're drawing the shape. We're guessing where the outputs will be. So that output makes sense. What if I put in this input? Well, it looks like it probably will give me a point there, and this one will probably give me a point right about there, and this one maybe there, 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 there. That's what I kind of think. Going to happen. Let me show you what somebody else might put down, and they could be right too. What's that? Oh, somebody else. Okay, somebody else thinks, because of like this point that they see, maybe I'm going to get outputs, like they're going to get bigger a little bit faster, and I'm going to go up, and then the points are going to kind of level out maybe, and then come up towards 4. Okay? You may feel like they go more straight. Somebody else feels like it kind of curves a little more, the pattern of the points. Who can really know who's right or wrong until you plug in those points and figure out what the outputs actually are? But the point I'm making is the shape that we draw in between there is where our guess of all the points would be, where the guess of all the outputs would be. That's a reasonable set of points. That's a reasonable set of outputs to come out of this function, given what we know about negative 2, negative 3. Okay, you think it's going to just keep going like this? Probably not. Why? Why would it probably not do that? There's a point down here, right? I bet that since there's a point, an output at negative 6, that at some point I'm going to start getting outputs that are less than 4. as I move to the right, as I put in bigger and bigger x values, I bet I'm going to start getting these smaller outputs somewhere here, here, and here, and here. I bet all the outputs are going to land like something like that. Your shape may look slightly different. That's not really the point. It's just we're making our best guess. I think all the points will land on that curve. And then as I come to here, I kind of feel like I'm going to get some. I mean, this change so drastically fast. I kind of feel like maybe there's some numbers that are less than -6 even, that are smaller than -6. So I think I'll get some that are less than -6. And then I'll start to get values that are more, you know, close to 0. I think that's what's going to happen. If you draw something that looks more like this, who's to say who's right until we plug those x values in? You don't know, but it's a good guess. So that's what we know about in between the points that we plotted. What about beyond the points that we plotted? So it'll go up really far. It'll go up like twice as high as this graph goes and a little bit more. Okay? So I know there's some point up there that I'm probably get a bunch of points in between that one and this one. So it seems reasonable that if I were to just draw it as going off the graph, I shouldn't quite get to x equals 3 if I'm thinking about it kind of hard. I shouldn't get quite to x is 3. I won't get to x is 3 until y is 24. So maybe I'll just kind of draw it that way. What do you think once it gets to 24? Like, do you think the graph will come back down? Do you think I'll start getting these points here? Okay, yes is a fine answer. Shrug is a fine answer. Who's to say?
There was a
nod. Okay.
I don't know. I found a little card. I nodded.
You nodded?
I don't feel my participation.
These are good guesses, good answers. Like, it could go up all the way forever and ever and ever, or it could come back down. I'm not sure. How could we get convinced that one or the other thing happens?
Plug
what
in?
Which points?
The ones that you're guessing on.
Which, you tell me which one to guess on.
And,
well, we don't know how big it is, right?
Four.
We got to plug in 4 to figure out
what we get.
Can we figure out what we get if we put in 4 real quick?
Yeah.
Let's see, you got 64, you got 32 minus 20, 64, that's 92, so 72, 56, not too far off, right? 56, what do you think? Well, you think the graph might at some point start getting points that start going back down? I think 52 is just seems too high. It seems like the trend is it'll always just keep getting higher. If you're not sure still, put in 5, put in 6, put in 7, let's put in 10. 10's a really easy thing to do. 10 cubed is 1,000. Okay, so 1,000 plus 200. So we're at 1,200 minus 50, 1150, minus 6. So 1144. We get out to 10, we're at 1044 is our output. So this definitely does not represent the graph as it actually should look. So we should erase that, right? That's false. Well, maybe farther to the right we come back down. What do you think? Probably not. At 10, we're at 1044. Something about this function seems to imply the numbers will just keep getting bigger. Bigger and bigger, and every time you move to the right on the x-axis, you will move up on the y-axis. That's a great question. That's a two-fold look. If you do that, okay. You know, just write the stuff down. Again, if you don't get any of this stuff, you still get 15 out of 20. Make a whole lot. What if we go to the left? What will happen? A really fast way to do it, a really just quick way to get convinced that it goes one way or the other, that the inputs will be more negative or more positive, is just plug something in that is pretty far to the left, right? And something that's pretty far to the left is 10, negative 10. We can plug in negative 10 and just see what happens. What are you going to get when you cube negative 10? negative 10 times negative 10 times negative 10.
Negative 1,000, yes.
Negative 1,000, that's pretty big in the negative direction, right? Oh, but now we're gonna add something. What do you think about this thing? When we square a negative, right, square negative 10, we're gonna get a positive. Do you think that's gonna like bring the output up very much? From negative 1,000? Why not? 200, that's pretty big. If I had $1,000 and I lost $200, I'd be kind of sad. All right, but what if we put in a bigger number? Do you think at some point this number and this number are going to be very far apart? Would you imagine that? And this number, what's this number going to be when we put a negative into it?
Negative.
Always negative, right? It seems like this x cubed is a very big deal, right? A lot of people know about this x cubed. And it will always be negative when we plug a negative number into it. This will be always positive, it just won't be as big as what x cubed is, at least its magnitude, like its absolute value will be smaller than that. So the negativeness of this is just nothing for this to compete with. And that's the only thing that even has a hope of bringing it back up, because all these things are going to be negative. Oh, this is going to be positive, though. But what's this going to be compared to x cubed? Not much. The only time that these are kind of close to each other is when x is smaller, when x is close to zero. Does that make sense? Right? We have to have, that's why we see so much, you know, squirminess and variation in the outputs, is because it actually does make a difference what x is when in this expression when we're more small. But once the numbers start to get really big that we're plugging in for x cubed is like in charge. It just kind of takes over and drives the ship, and nobody else can tell it what to do, right? So what do you think? What kind of outputs are we going to get as we go this way?
Negative.
Just this. I mean, this conversation is very significant that you're thinking about this. It's very powerful. And if you can continue to think this way, you'll have so few confusions about graphs. The confusions about graphs come when we try to shortcut drawing those points, right? Finding special points that will help us graph it faster. Right? But that's when we start to think like it's a shape to be drawn correctly, and as if it was a magic shape that we couldn't understand. The shape is really, let's see if I said this clearly enough. What is this shape? How does this shape come to be into existence?
It's instead of filling out all the points, it's all the points that are possible from the function.
And we're just saying what all the points are that are possible.
Yeah, all the possible points in the function.
Yes. Here you go.
You
ready? A very good thrower. Exactly. It's just all the possible points. But we don't have the time to plot all the possible points, so we're going to draw a shape that we think all the points would wind up melting into and creating. Exactly. Okay. So, I actually have another point to make about this. Now, if we think about this, something goes in and something comes out of this function, and then we plot this point. Let me erase what we've drawn, and we'll talk about why certain shapes are kind of nonsensical when we know that the function, that whatever we see here is a representation of it. Put this in, you get this out. So a shape like this, and then maybe it goes like this and like that. All right. Now, I bet that this kind of a shape comes from thinking I'm going to connect them from top to bottom. If you connect them from left to right, if you're still forcing yourself to think of it as what is the shape, right, rather than, well, what will the outputs be? That's how you should be thinking. But if you're thinking what is the shape, if you connect it from left to right, you will not have problems, okay? Don't do from top to bottom. Let me show you what the problem is here. Now that we understand that this shape is just all of the possible points and the points represent the outputs, right, for the given inputs, are we all cool with cool on that? I'm not confusing you, right?
No.
Okay. So, now that we know that, any point on the graph will be a point representing an input and output. Let's look at, let's just look at this guy right here. What is this saying about the function? What will I get according to this graph if I put in negative 2? If I put in negative 2, I'll get 0. That's where that point is, right? There's a point on the graph right there. If I put in 0, what will I get? 0. If I put in 2 or 1, what will I get?
0.
What point am I making here? Well, this graph is saying that anything between negative 3 and positive 2 will always give you a 0. Does that seem believable?
No.
No. That seems kind of weird. Let's take 0 for example. What's the problem, especially at 0? Because we already know something about 0. When you put out 0,
you get negative 6.
You get negative 6.
Yeah.
You get negative 6. We already know what you should get. Could you also get 0? Oh, did we get 0 as well? Could you imagine even something that you would put a number into, do all the computation, and get 2 numbers? No, even if there were, it would have to look a lot more crazy than this. This is not crazy, this is normal. We just square a number, we just cube a number, we multiply by a number, we add them together, we get one result, right? So what this graph is saying is when you plug in 0, yes, you get negative 6. You also are going to get 0, and you're also going to get what?
9.
9, right? It says you're going to get 3 numbers when you put one number in, all right? So this thing that we're talking about here is the second part of the definition of the function, and that is when you put something in, one thing in, how many things should you get out? One thing, okay? Now we can get graphs that cross, like, vertically over themselves. You can graph a circle, you can graph an ellipse, you can graph all sorts of things that, like, one part of the graph is over itself. But you know what that graph is not of?
A function.
No. It's not of a function, because a function can't have two outputs. Maybe we could put two functions together, like two different graphs with two different functions. Now we can start to get these shapes. But, yeah, it's not a function if that's what's going on. Okay. So, in-depth answer, you're getting multiple outputs for a single input. That can't be, this cannot be the graph of that function. All right. We know that when we put one thing in, we should only get one thing out. All right. Not as good explanation, you know, not as good a practice, but still it's going to get you the right kind of shape. Connect your points from left to right. If you connect them from left to right, you make sure to go from this one and then to this point. And then don't jump over to this point before you get to this one. You're not going to draw a graph that crosses back over itself, right? And not representing something that gives you two things for one thing in. All right. So, you don't like that. Let's put the other one back. There we go. And we'll do 13 real quick. 13 is like a really nice function. Because we can pick numbers that are easy to plug in. And I only picked one that wasn't easy. We put something into this function, what do we do with that thing that we put into this function? Take the square root, okay? So things that have nice square roots can be easy things to plug into this function. All but one of those things, all but one of these x's, is a nice thing to plug into the square root. What's the square root of 0?
0.
Why is the square root of 0 0? Is what?
0 times 0.
Because 0 times 0 is 0. Not even just anything times 0 is 0. 0 times 0, right? Because why is the square root of 4? 2.
2 times 2 is 4.
Okay. And the square root of 9. All right. I threw this one in there just to show you, other numbers have square roots. They're just not as nice. So it's the square root of 6. I think it was 2.449, and I rounded up to 5. All right. So we plot these things. 0, 0, 1, 1, 4, 2, 6, 2.45, that's there, 9, 3. So as we come along here, whatever we put in, what we get out is just the square root of that number. Yeah. So how about where would we go to to get a, like before we get up to 4 here, how far would we have to go to get up to 4?
16.
Okay, you gotta go out to 16 before you get a y of 4. Okay. So anyway, coming back here, what's the square root of a half? Somewhere between 0 and 1, somewhere maybe right there. And all these square roots of these numbers are something like this, and then those ones will connect that one and connect it to that one, because we guessed that all the points are gonna be somewhere on this curve that we've drawn. Right? Okay. and that pretty much does it for that. But let's talk about what it keeps doing. Like, as it goes this way, what do you think this graph will do? Very gradually, right? It'll not do like this function did, right? And just shoot off like a rocket up, right? But it will. Will it ever? I mean, like, could it ever get up to 1,000? Sure. Wait, to get up to 1,000, we'd have to go all the way out to whatever is the square of 1,000, so that the square root of that number is 1,000, right? Yeah. We have to go, you know, we could get up to 1,000,000, we just have to go out to 1,000,000 squared. So then we take the square root of that, and we get 1,000,000. This is just really slow. And if you go far enough out, it'll start to look, how would you describe the shape of it? As you get really far to the right.
Steeper.
You go get steeper and steeper. It will look like it plateaus, but will it ever plateau? No, because if it ever plateaus, that means, well, you can't get to this, but you can't get to that high, right? So no, it doesn't quite plateau, but it already starts to look kind of horizontal, and you go out far enough. So let's talk about this way.
I was just going to say, like, how you square root a negative.
Okay, keep going.
I just didn't know, like, you had -9 and you square rooted that, would it be like 3 or -3?
That's a good question. That's a broken If you square root -9, is it like what? What is it like? Why not? Yeah, Cindy?
Because
3
times 3
times
9,
negative 3 times -3 is 9. Right. I mean, you're right about that. Why is that? Why are we making that point? It's got to be the same number, right? We've got to multiply something by itself to get the square root of a number, right? So it's got the only things that we feel like might work are 3 times 3. That's positive 9. That doesn't work. Negative 3 times negative 3. That almost feels like it would work. But that's still positive 9. And so we say, hey, what about 3 times negative 3? That works. That's, yeah, that square root is defined as a number times itself gives you that number. So you can't have two different numbers. Which one is it? Is it 3 or is it negative 3? It's not either of those. 3i, which we'll talk about long into the future. Well, maybe not that long, but not today. So, as we move this way, what do we do with the graph? What do we do about it? Where do we plot the points? What's that? We said what?
Nothing.
Nothing. We don't do anything. Oh, could have thrown
it.
Good, I thought it would be better. Okay. Yes, that's my goal. So what Cindy said, and why I threw an egg at her and made her drop it, was you don't do anything, right? Because what do you get as an output when you put in negative numbers into the square root? Nothing. You just shout into the void, and nothing comes back. There's no square roots of negative numbers in the real numbers. So we get nothing, no outputs for Negative square roots. Square roots of negatives. Okay. So that's good. Let's just leave it at that. I could go into something else, but I don't want to confuse it. But. So there we go. That's what graphs are. It's just all of the points. All of the points. That makes a graph. Right, so if we start to think about that, if we start to cross back over ourselves on a graph, we think, wait a minute, that means that I would have to get this and this output if I put in just one input. That doesn't make sense. That can't be a function. Right. All right, so any more questions? I don't have any up here. Okay. Did you have a question?
Oh, no. Yeah.
A little finger stretch. Okay. Everyone else pass in our homework, please, and get ready for a review. 57 points. Doug scored P of those points. Expression for the percent, the total. Okay. If Doug made 12 points, what would we do with 12 points to figure out his percentage of the team points?
Divide 12 by 57.
We get it. Right? And whatever 12, or not whatever 12 is, whatever this number might be, we'll do the same thing. Any number I tell you, you'll divide it by 57, right? So when I say whatever number this is, I can represent whatever number this is with
x.
Or p. I gave you p there. So you could use p. If you use x, that's fine. Right? There might be other times where it's important to use the right letter, but okay, so this is fine. This is what I was looking for mainly. But technically, does this tell you the percent?
No.
What do you have to do to this?
Multiply it by
100. Multiply it by 100, yeah. You gotta use it with the decimal, which is the same as multiplying by 100, right? The rule for if you multiply by 10 or 100 or 1,000 or 1 with a bunch of zeros, you move it over the number of zeros. So there ain't that number. Okay. Come on in. Any questions about that? If it's p over 57, that's good. If it's this, that's great. If it's equals d or something like that, that's all right. But if it's equal to like d times 2 or something, then now we have trouble. Now it's starting to look like you don't quite understand what we're doing here. Okay? Because it's not equal to d times 2, it's just equal to d, right? Or if this is, yeah, it's just weird. So I get a couple of those here and there. So we'll just put a 3 or something like that. So I'm gonna erase that so anybody looking at the notes is not confused. That's the main guy right there. That's the following expression. Alright. So we have a scary. If you think about it, whenever you see stuff multiplied and divided, you know, by each other, it kind of makes it a little group, like a term. And that's why we call it a term, right? It's like a group of stuff that's multiplied together, and then it's broken up by addition and subtraction. So anytime you see a group like that, like this, really, including the negative, you can kind of just evaluate each of those independently in the same step. So what are we going to do to evaluate this guy here, or to simplify this one?
Distribute
the 5x minus 35 times 35. Then we're going to distribute here as well. We're going to distribute what?
3x.
That's what I was looking for. OK, negative 3x. So we're going to distribute negative 3x, and we're going to get?
What?
Oh, you're shocked.
I can throw eggs at
people. Because they love it.
It
should be to the third, yes.
Minus
6x
squared.
Minus 6x squared, thank you.
Plus
15x.
No, he just needs an egg.
I know.
Okay. I think that's fair. He's going for it.
Dude, they sound like capsules when they're making
capsules of what?
I don't like.
They are.
That's what Easter egg is.
Do you put it back? No, never mind. Just continue with the list.
All right, here we go. The x cubed, that's the only x cubed that there is. Okay? So that's it. There's nothing to put it with. Square, that's the only one. No other like terms of that. We got 15x and 5x, so we got 20x.
Minus 35.
I thought I had written 20x incorrectly. 20x minus 35.
Sorry, that's my shoe. It's wet. We were outside lunching.
How'd it go?
It went really well, actually, but it smoked and it sucked, so.
What?
It was smoky.
Oh,
yeah.
It's really smoky.
Sorry.
Where's the fire now?
I don't know.
Idaho, Canada, Wyoming.
It's nasty.
And Oregon. And Washington.
Okay, so there we go. If I ever go too quickly and you didn't quite get it, just tell me to go back. I tell you what, if you ever catch my mistake, if I make a mistake, you know, I'll throw you a name for that as well. Okay, so evaluate where x equals -3. And remember, my suggestion is for parentheses, empty set of parentheses in place of every x, and then plug your number in. Empty parentheses. And now we go. -3. -3 times -3, right? We're squaring something, multiply by itself, -3.
Nine.
What do we, okay. So now what do we do? Good, right? Multiplication. First, -4 times -3. Not 9 minus 4. Okay, so plus 12 divided by 6 times 3.
12 divided by 6.
Okay, why 12 divided by 6?
Order of operations.
Order of operations, yeah, but.
Left to right.
Oh, that was alright. 9 plus 12 divided by 6.
Oh, man, that really rolled.
2 times 3. Okay, so we divide. When we're trying to choose between division and multiplication, right? 6 basically is involved in either division or multiplication. We're trying to decide which. We should choose division, right? Division and multiplication from left to right.
Okay.
2 times 3 is 6, so 9 plus 6, 15. So if you have an egg, just fill it out. The ones that have been filled out have been fantastic. It's been really just entertaining and like really great. Right, the responses that we're getting, the questions that are asked, the comments that are made, they're great. When you're done with it, I want them separate. Okay, you got a little white. Don't get up to do this. Do this at the end of class. Okay, but you can drop the eggs in there, and you can just leave the slips of paper next to that. Okay. Eventually I'll have a nicer system, but I just threw this together today.
You have to get your belt.
Yeah,
just like on the ceiling, you put a piece of paper.
Yeah, yeah. Alright. So, we talked about this maybe ad nauseum. Do you know what ad nauseum means?
Enough to make you sick. To the point of making you ill.
We talked about it a lot. We went into depth. So I won't go into as much depth this time. We're going to plug -1 into the function. Make sure that we get those negatives in the right place by filling in those empty parentheses with the value that we're plugging in. -1 squared is going to be +1. -3 times -1 is going to be +3. -1, that's 5. This clearly gives us 1. 1 is going to be just like this, except it's going to be 1 minus 3. -1. Okay, great. I'll just trust you on that. No points for tricking me into making a mistake and then fixing it. Okay. So we're gonna plot. Here's what we're really gonna do. We're gonna represent this input-output relationship with a point on a plane, right? A flat surface. These aren't even We wouldn't even say plot these points. These aren't even points. They're not points until we want to make them points. This point can represent this input output. That's what we're really talking about. So negative 1, 5, 0, 1, 1, negative 1, 2, negative 1, 2, negative 1, 3, 1. So when we go to draw the graph, draw the shape, we're really okay, yes, to avoid mistakes, to make a fair looking graph, do it from left to right. That's a good piece of advice, like a little trick, right, to remember, or to at least avoid mistakes. But really what we're supposed to be thinking about is this graph is actually inputs and outputs. Exactly. All the possible points. Right? As Caleb put earlier. All the possible points, that's what the graph is. It's not even what the graph represents, it is what the graph is. It is all the possible points. All the trillions and trillions upon trillions and trillions of points drawn so close together you can't tell the difference anymore between one and the next. I start to see the shape. So the in-between part, that's easy. Then we have to ask ourselves, you know, I can graph this in-between stuff fine, but once I go beyond it, I start to have to ask myself, what will the function keep on doing? What kind of outputs will I continue to get as I put in bigger and bigger x's? It is a parabola. You might be familiar with parabolas. You might know that it's supposed to be a parabola because we have an x squared, and that's the highest power of the function. Okay, so we know it should just keep going up like this, right? Parabolas either open up or down. As we can see, this is an opening up kind of a parabola. Also, we talked about it ad nauseum, the function with the x cubed in it, and how basically whatever power is the biggest on the x is going to be the biggest number in the expression when x is big. When x is big is an important part of that. When x is a very big number, this will be far greater than this. And when we try to subtract this from this definitely positive number, it's not going to do a whole lot. Does that make sense? It's going to be too big for minus 3x to compete with. 1,000 minus 300. Another 1,000. Another 1,000. 10,000. Minus 300. Plus 1. Plus 1. Definitely going to be some positive number that would be at 100. We plugged in 100 right there. It just skyrocketed. It just keeps going, keeps going, keeps going. Okay. If you have questions, ask them. If not, tally up the score. It's out of 20. Right? Four questions. Each question is 5.
Whole thing is 5. Yes. So
the whole question 4 is worth 5.
So without the graph.
Without
but
the graph?
But she's got it. Never
okay.
She's good.
If you can't make up your mind, you can just leave it blank. I'm going to score it later too. So. Okay.